This is a live look at the Toronto sign at Nathan Phillips Square, dimmed tonight, as you can see, in honor of the 63 Canadian lives lost in the Ukraine International Airlines crash last night. The CN Tower also going dark. People in the city of Toronto and across the GTA grieving tonight. Good evening, I'm Mike Wise. Many of those victims were from the GTA. We'll have more on them in just a second. First, though, the latest on what we know about the crash. The Boeing 737-800 went down minutes after taking off from Tehran's main airport on a flight to Kiev. All 176 people on board died. The cause of that crash has not been determined, but Iranian state TV says both of the plane's flight recorders have been recovered. But it's not clear if that data will be shared with Boeing. The airliner was only 3 years old and had undergone routine maintenance just 2 days ago. Satellite-based tracking firms say they are sharing location data with authorities. Prime Minister Trudeau tonight made a promise to Canadians that that crash would be thoroughly investigated. Now 138 passengers on board were headed for Canada. Many were said to be students on their way back to Canada after the holiday break, including several young people from right here in Toronto. High school and university students with their whole lives ahead of them. Kelda Yoon has more on that.
Outside Northern Secondary School, a flag flies half-mast to honor Maya Zabai.
Maya was a new Canadian, an amazing young kid, very ambitious.
She was a very nice person. She didn't really speak a lot because she's maybe a bit shy, but I hope that if you got to know her, she was very nice and she's very smart.
Zabai was visiting Iran with her mother, both dying in the crash.
I think we're all still trying to digest this and what it means, and to have something so far away hit so close to home.
York Region High School student Arad Zurey has also been identified as one of the victims. The 18-year-old was in his final year at Richmond Green Secondary School. His dad said he was visiting his mother in Iran. In a statement, he said of his son, "He was the apple of my eye, and his energetic demeanor and caring personality left a lasting impression on his classmates and many friends." Six students studying at the University of Toronto were also on the flight, including brother and sister Mohammed and Zainab Asadilari. Zainab was the president of the STEM fellowship at the school. Mohammed was an MD who has given TED Talks in the past.
And there will be issues that you're passionate about, and you need to take action on those issues.
There's also U of T student Mohammed Salihi, remembered by his friend for always being there for anyone.
I mean, all the different people who knew him, from different backgrounds, with different personalities, everybody really liked him. And I'm really shocked that why this should happen to someone like Mohammed. I want to say that all the lives on that plane are very, very valuable. Mohammed is just one example of them to me.
At the University of Guelph, researcher Ghanimat Ajdari is being remembered as a force of nature for her work with nomadic peoples. And at the University of Windsor, students mourn the loss of Samir Bashiri and her husband, Hamid.
We were all sad last night. We were all awake to... We hope that they did miss their flights.
And the University of Western has also confirmed that four of its students were also on that flight. Three of them were engineering students.
I do have students here. Now, I'm sure the shock of all this, Kelda, is still settling in for both students, for teachers on this. Many are going to be no doubt seeking some sort of assistance in the days ahead.
That's right. The TDSB has sent social workers to all the schools that are affected. They will be working alongside guidance counselors to help support the students. The York Region District School Board, same goes for them. The social workers were there today. They'll be there again tomorrow. Now, U of T has also compiled a list of links to resources to help support their students. And they also held a private vigil on campus tonight to honor the six lives that were lost. And tomorrow, a large public vigil will be held at North York Civic Center.
Such a somber evening. We'll be there as well. Thank you, Kelda. Now, for many families, now begins the incredibly painful journey to Tehran to identify the remains of their loved ones. Tonight at Pearson Airport, CBC producer Simon Dingley spoke to one Toronto man who lost his wife in the crash. Here's part of that conversation.
She works here. She took 3 weeks off to visit her mom and her sisters and come back. I spoke to her on WhatsApp 20 minutes before the plane took off, and she wanted me to assure her that there wasn't going to be a war. And I told her not to worry. Nothing's going to happen. She said, okay, they're telling me to turn off my phone. Goodbye. And that was it.
And she posted this picture?
When the plane was going down. She wrote, I'm leaving, but behind me there are worries. Behind me there are worries. I'm scared for the people that are behind. She was a chemist. She saved my life. I lived because of her. I was married to her for 10 years. Very short 10 years. I don't know. I lived for her.
Such heartbreaking loss. I'm also at the airport headed for Tehran tonight was Hamid Ismailion from Richmond Hill. He lost his wife and young daughter in the crash. Our Lorenda Redikoff spoke to him earlier at his home today.
It's an unimaginable grief. Hamid Ismailion lost his wife Parisa and their only child, 9-year-old Rira.
You know, first thing that comes to your mind is that you don't believe that. I still don't believe that it happened.
He's supported by close friends as he prepares for a difficult journey to fly to Iran to identify the bodies.
I said, I have to go. And when I said to myself that I have to go, I felt better a little bit. Because at the beginning, I was telling them that, you know, send over the bodies here. I want to bury them here. And, but then I said, no, my mom and my mother-in-law, they have rights too. So I have to go back and, you know, share the grief, I think. And
he was already so worried about his family last night before their flight took off, given the tensions between Iran and the U.S. And then the missiles launched into Iraq. While this is difficult, he wants to share his family's story to honor them.
There are tensions in Iran, but I don't want this thing to be forgotten. So people will talk about Iran and U.S. and everything, and this people in this plane will be forgotten. I don't want that.
He says his daughter loved sports, played piano, and was gifted at languages, spoke English, French, and Farsi.
We had a very, very, very great relationship. I was teasing her all the time, and, you know, she was a funny girl, and she was the best ever, I think.
Today, he had to make a difficult call to her school in Richmond Hill, Adrian Clarkson Public School.
I told them that, okay, Rira will be absent forever. So that was a hard moment for me. I said, she was an amazing girl and I have to talk about her. And my wife too.
His wife was a dentist, like him. They met in university in Iran and had a practice together in Aurora. He says she was a perfectionist, smart, and that he was always learning from her.
I think it was not right. I think it was not fair what happened. So I wanted to talk about that because I'm still thinking about that flight. I can't bring them back, but I want to find what happened.
As he grieves, he's also looking for answers from the airplane manufacturer, the airline, and the airport they flew from. Lorenda Redikoff, CBC News, Richmond Hill.
Was just a handful of the lives that were lost in the GTA and across the country. Our online team has been working all day to make sure all of their stories are told. You can read more on our website, cbc.ca/Toronto. The GTA is home to the second largest Iranian population outside of Iran. And while that may seem big, many of them have some kind of connection to the plane crash. As Shannon Martin shows us, the community says the crash and the ongoing conflict with the United States is leaving them fearful about what could happen next.
This is the first time I'm seeing all the pictures. It's what I've been trying to avoid.
Marul Karemi is a PhD student at the University of Toronto. She grew up in Iran during the Iran-Iraq War. The last few days, she says, are reminiscent of her childhood.
So many people are afraid to go to sleep, because you don't know what's going to happen when you wake up.
Like so many, she's trying to process the latest. She still hasn't brought herself to look at the names of those who died in the plane crash.
We're a very tight-knit community. It's a very large community, but at the same time, almost everyone knows everyone. And I'm almost certain that if I look at that list, names would pop up.
About 100,000 Iranian Canadians call the GTA home, the second largest Iranian community outside of Iran. Inside this beloved Persian supermarket, the news broadcasts above the aisles of fresh fruit. The manager says some of those killed were his customers.
And all the people we can see very sad on their faces. They're all very worried what's going to happen. This couple weeks are... It's a very, very crucial time for all the Persian in Toronto.
The concern, he says, is constant among so many. Fears over more violence and maybe another war.
Even in the middle of the night, like 3 a.m., 4 a.m., I wake up and I just check my cell phone to see what's happened.
Arshan Parsi came to Toronto from Iran in 2006. He now helps LGBTQ refugees come to Canada.
You know, we'd like to call upon all international governments and, you know, individuals to take every possible diplomatic, you know, avenue to ask their governments, contact their, you know, local representative to de-escalate the situation, because there is too much war going on in the world, and we cannot afford it anymore.
Shannon Martin, CBC News, Toronto.
Well, let's talk about the weather forecast right now with meteorologist Colette Kennedy with a first look at what to expect.
Yeah, that's right, Mike. We've got a few things that we need to go through, and I think we're going to talk mostly about the next 24 hours, and then I'm going to get into some detail on this storm that's coming for the weekend a little bit later in the show. But let me just give you some of the highlights. Okay, I don't know if it's a highlight, but in terms of what's happening with the wind chills, feeling like close to minus 20, close to minus 15 for southwestern Ontario, but they're significant overnight tonight. Also, looking at this next system coming in, so late tomorrow, we'll find perhaps a bit of a mix, but as temperatures will actually be rising, it'll be more so a showery situation. But the weekend impact, we do have a special weather statement, and that's the thing I'm going to get into coming up a little later. But just showing you what happens with some of these squalls we've been seeing through the evening hours, as those winds back off, so too do those squalls. So we get into a situation with some quieter conditions on Thursday. It's kind of the calm before the storm. Clouds will be increasing through the day, and then it's late Thursday we'll start to see some spotty showers or a little bit of a mix, especially into cottage country. Your temperature tonight, minus 13. There it is, feeling like almost minus 20. Increase in clouds tomorrow, but what a turnaround with those temperatures. We'll be at zero, and then the temperature rising even from there tomorrow evening as we head towards Friday. I'll have all those numbers coming up, Mike.
Okay, thanks, Colette. Well, still ahead, we have a wrap of the rest of the day's local news. We'll tell you where in the GTA last night's Lotto Max record-breaking ticket was sold, plus a bizarre find outside Dufferin Mall.
What company that sells clothes to kids would do this?
A children's clothing company may be making a big change after unsold clothes were found outside their store in a dumpster. That's coming up. It is back to school tomorrow for the high school students in the 9 Ontario school boards hit with the latest one-day teacher strike today. But that job action is now canceling next week's standardized math test for all grade 9 students right across the province.
The union leaders have directed their members not to prepare students for the grade 9 math assessment for EQAL. This is why we're here today.
Education Minister is giving school boards the authority to postpone that standardized test. In work to rule campaigns, both Catholic and public teachers are refusing to administer the tests. Boards in Toronto and Peel are rescheduling them for June. There's still no bargaining date set for the OSSTF, although Catholic teachers have 2 days of negotiations planned starting tomorrow. We have new video to show you tonight showing what happened immediately after Peel police shot at a man at a Mississauga townhouse complex last night. A neighbor filmed this video just seconds after police opened fire. The man drove his car into a house. Officers can be seen smashing the car's windows, then later pulling a seemingly unconscious man from the driver's seat. Now, what led up to that incident is unclear. The SIU is now investigating and says the 28-year-old driver is in hospital in critical condition. The townhouse suffered structural damage as a result of the crash and had to be stabilized before the car could be removed today for further examination. And one Toronto mom's surprising discovery outside the Dufferin Mall is leading to a big change tonight from a children's clothing retailer. On Monday, the woman found bags of new clothing from Carter's Oshkosh that had been destroyed and dumped instead of being donated to families in need.
It was a whole bunch of things. Like, I was just like, what? And I just kept digging through till I could find anything that was salvageable.
Now, we found a charity called Brands for Canada that could pick up overstock or returned items from retailers and was willing to redistribute the items to children in need. Now, the retailer tells us the items in question were damaged or unusable and disposed of for safety reasons. But tonight, Oshkosh says it is now willing to work with Brands for Canada to donate all overflow items in the future. And someone who lives in Brampton may be the lucky winner of last night's record-breaking Lotto Max jackpot. That's where the single winning ticket was sold worth $70 million, but the winner has yet to come forward to claim the prize. There are also other big winners in addition to the jackpot. That's including 6 players in Ontario who each won $1 million in Tuesday's draw.
It's a nice dress, so the prize, it shows like 174, right? And it will be 90% off, so probably it will be like, around under 20.
And believe it or not, there still is Zellers up and running here in Toronto. Etobicoke is home to one of the last 2 Zellers stores in Canada, and it'll be closing its doors at the end of the month. Consumers have been flocking there to try to score some deals, but with a small number of cashiers and some technical issues punching in the sales, lineups have been averaging a couple of hours in some cases.
The weather update is brought to you by Trane, the most reliable heating and cooling brand. It's hard to stop a Trane.
Well, the Leafs hosting the Jets tonight, and this one gets off to a weird start. Freddie Anderson goes for the puck, though. Nick Ehlers fires one into the empty net. Don't worry, though. Anderson would turn things around. And a minute later, Mitch Marner finds Austin Matthews. That would tie the game. That's actually his 30th goal of the season. Skip to the third. It's 3-2 Winnipeg. 18 seconds to go. Morgan Rielly finds Matthews. He sends this game to overtime. Thanks to Anderson, Toronto stays in it. They survive until it goes to a shootout, then tied at one. Matthews slides one in to take the lead. The Jets would tie it again, then Blake Wheeler wins it. In the fourth round, the Jets beat Toronto with a 4-3 shootout. The Raptors game also going to OT. The Charlotte Hornets were up by 10 with 6 minutes to go. Toronto would rally back. 20 seconds on the clock here. Kyle Lowry penetrates to the key, falls to the ground, but scores off the glass. Toronto up by one. Now, after an Ibaka foul allowed the Hornets to tie the game, Devontae Graham with the Hornets comes up short. This goes to overtime where it remained tight. Game was tied at 1-10. Ibaka gathers the ball. He gets fouled here. He would hit both free throws for a two-point lead. 3.3 seconds remaining. Terry Rozier tries for victory, but it's off the mark. The Raptors hold on for the win. Colette Kennedy's back with her extended forecast. This time last night, Colette, we were talking about how cold it was going to feel tonight. It certainly is, but it's going to be totally different tomorrow night.
Yeah, it's going to change around again, Mike. That's right. And that's kind of the positive part about this next system that's going to be moving in as we head towards the weekend, that we'll see milder temperatures. But there's going to be a host of potential problems with this system as well. And that's why the special weather statement in place, keeping in mind this is for the weekend, this is more for Saturday. But the system begins to make itself known even as early as tomorrow evening. So once we get towards Saturday, heavy rain potential, there's certainly that. Freezing rain or ice pellets, we could even see an accretion of ice. And then on the backside, as temperatures actually fall and move back onto the cold side of things, we may see some snow or certainly a mix then changing into some wet snow. So let's walk you through. We'll start off just with what we're looking at through the overnight tonight. Those winds backing off, it helps those snow squalls to drop off as well. We start the day off tomorrow pretty decently, meaning not a lot of active weather. Now, Thursday, as we go into the evening hours, we'll start to see some showers, somewhat scattered or a little spotty in nature, coming into southwestern Ontario. A bit of a mix, pushing through cottage country, headed towards the GTA. And then as temperatures continue to rise overnight tomorrow night into Friday, we'll see it turning over to all liquid precipitation in terms of rain. And some of it, especially close to the lakeshore here, northern shore of Lake Erie, but eventually even Lake Ontario, some heavier bouts. We may see over 50 millimeters of rain once this has all worked its way through into Saturday for southwestern Ontario, because watch what happens. There comes that influx of all this moisture. This is as we're going through Saturday, so Friday night into Saturday, and then on the backside with some of that moisture in place, but that colder air at the surface, we may see freezing rain or ice pellets. That's this area you see here in pink. And that could be significant, meaning lasting for a few hours and building up before we get into some of that wet snow on the backside. So in terms of that ice accretion, if you look over here at the legend, some areas may see this 20 to 25 millimeters, and that includes close to the city. So this is going to be something to very, very carefully be watching as we go into the weekend. We'll get the timing and the adjustment of that system as we get closer. Southwestern Ontario feeling like minus 15 overnight tonight, and then tomorrow, look at that. Big turnaround with those temperatures getting milder with the southeasterly breeze. It'll take a little more time to turn things around. So after a cold overnight tonight in the GTA, this is where we go into the afternoon, but then continuing to climb from there. Look at some of the numbers we're talking about with this mild air in place Friday into Saturday. It's unfortunate that we couldn't just have that with sunny skies, Mike. Yeah. Instead, we've got this very complex system that we will be dealing with and bad travel conditions.
And we'll track it as it gets closer, certainly, as well. Thanks, Colette.
You're welcome.
As you saw earlier, the Maple Leafs played on home ice tonight against the Winnipeg Jets. Before we go, we want to show you a moment before puck drop. A moment of silence was held for the victims of the Ukrainian Airlines crash in Tehran.
Ladies and gentlemen, we ask that you please rise if you're able to and remove your hats. Last night, a plane heartbreakingly crashed near Iran's capital, Tehran, claiming the lives of 176 people, 63 of which were Canadian. Our thoughts and condolences are with the families and friends of those impacted by this devastating tragedy. We now ask that you join together with the Winnipeg Jets and your Toronto Maple Leafs in a moment of silence. Thank you.
And that's our newscast for tonight. To follow the latest on the Iranian plane crash, check our website overnight. Our colleagues on Metro Morning will also be speaking with many who knew the people killed in the crash. And Matt Galloway will also bring you the latest in that story on The Current. That's tomorrow on CBC Radio 1. I'll see you back here tomorrow night at 11. Good night.